All right, Suraj, am I audible and visible?
Yeah, you're perfectly audible and visible. No issues.
Hello everyone, good afternoon. I am Rohit Joshi. Currently, I'm the Google Developer Student Clubs lead at PCCA. And formerly, I was a junior webmaster at PCCA ACM student chapter. So any further, I would like to turn off my camera because the platform demands heavy internet. Do not keep the camera on,
but as of now,
I will turn it off. So I hope we can go further. Suraj, is the screen visible?
No, that's visible. Go ahead.
Cool. All right. So the session we are having today is based on open source. So that, as the title says, get going with open source. So we'll be going through all the basics and
various things.
So in the next one, I would like, so we'll be starting off with the very basic
having
about what is
contribute to open source.
Then next is what is version, the difference,
then GitHub, and then a surprise for everyone. So I'm sure you will stick till the end to see the surprise, and I'm sure.
Cool.
So does anyone have any idea?
Would you like to share what is open source in your layman terms? You can drop it in the chat. Anyone?
Your screen is visible. I guess you should reshare it.
Okay, let me reshare it. Was I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible. And to the audience, guys, as the portal, so you may have to bear with some network issues. Sorry for the inconvenience. Yeah, Rohit, it's perfectly visible now.
Okay. So I hope it is now visible completely. I'm on the what is open source slide.
Yeah, it's visible.
Okay, so I guess please check other project.
It is like a box of cookie where one can taste and
use and awesome. Modify, make better a code. Okay, Rugved, Animesh. Thank you everyone. Awesome answers. I mean, Mugda. Platform
where
can answer. All the
given.
Yep, absolutely. So
thank you everyone for the answers.
I'm really happy that you all have a basic understanding of what is open source. Just
to move further and let everyone know what open source is. So basically the term open source
that
is publicly available, and so
everyone can write something upon it. And
talking in
reference with
programmers who have access to this open source code can change
feature,
fix a bug, etc.
Because the entire source
public platform. So you can always go and check it out. You can contribute, you can
try
checking out different open source projects. Majorly it is all about collaboration, and it is
not just about the community. It is about the mindset that you want to make publicly available software better, so that everyone who is using that software will have a better experience. So it's all about the mindset that you want to contribute, you want to help the software get better. Some of the other advantages that I would like to point out here are open source community discriminates you against your race, color, anything. Willingness to contribute, willingness
and share whatever.
That's it.
I have a question for you all.
What is the name of the first successful manned mission to moon? It was in the year 1969.
Hello Rohit, sorry to interrupt you. I guess now Apurva will share the screen. It would be better.
Sorry?
Actually, your net is quite weak. I will share the screen for you.
Yes, okay. Suraj, I don't have the, okay. Give me 1 second.
Well, as I said earlier, the platform demands heavy internet, some strong internet. I'm sure I need to contact my ISP now. Yep.
Is this visible?
Yep. Can you just cut off the sound?
Okay.
Yep. And next one. Yep. So I guess some of our attendees have Apollo, Siddesh, Purnesh, Mugda. Okay, everyone. Rugved, Tej. Oh, okay, awesome. Everyone knows actually. Next slide. Okay, that's sure. That's Apollo 11. And what if I told you that the lady that you are seeing on the screen, her name is Margaret Hamilton. So she was one of the most important person in this Apurva the screen.
It's on, no problem. You can proceed.
Screen is visible, cool. I mean, why am I not able to see it?
You can just proceed. Erwin, you can proceed ahead with no issues.
Yep. Just a second. Suraj, I guess I should rejoin. Yep. Okay. There you are. So the lady, I was talking about the lady on your screen. So her name is Margaret Hamilton. Suraj, am I audible? Yeah. So she was one of the most important person who was responsible for the first successful manned mission to moon, carrying Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin. So what if I told you that the code that which took man to the moon is now open source? It is completely open source. Apurva, can you just click on that link and open the link? I guess you have to share the window so
yes.
That
I'm sharing the window.
Yep, just scroll down a bit to the bottom. Yep, just one more. Yep, more. Okay, so there you can see, submitted by Margaret Hamilton, 28th March 1969, and all the other professors or scientists who were working on the project, Daniel Leakey, Fred Martin, etc. This is the original code which took man to the space, and now it is open source. Anyone can contribute, anyone can build upon it, but I'm not sure if anyone is willing to build upon it because it's quite complicated, but it is open source. So going back to our slide. Yep, next one. And this is not the only case. I mean, we have Android, Zulip, TensorFlow, Django, VS Code by Microsoft is also an open source. The monthly update that you get every time you VS Code, some of them are made by public developers. They are the ones who are developing or contributing and making VS Code a better IDE. Flutter, of course. Flutter is also one of the most active open source project currently, and React by Facebook is also one of them. Chromium, yes, Purnesh. Yep. And many more, I mean. Getting to the next slide. All right, I'm sure we have talked a lot about open source. We have talked about the Apollo 11. We have talked about some projects, but the question still stands still, because why should I contribute to open source? I mean, why do I need to, is the correct question. So moving to the next one. Okay, so some of the points that I want to highlight over here are, it helps in gaining deeper knowledge about the technology and project. So let me give you an example. Most of the times, the people who are using the software, or the developers who are using the software on a daily basis, are the ones who contribute the most to that software. Because some or the other time they incur or they encounter a bug and they try asking everyone if everyone is having the same bug. Then they move and they check in if the source code is having some issues. And then they come to know that, okay, everyone who is using this software is having some or the other issues at the correct point where I'm having the issue. So they code, they contribute, and they fix the issue. So how awesome is it that the code you are fixing or the bug you are, rectifying is the one everyone is having, and now you solved everyone's issue. So that's something awesome. I mean, you are impacting a lot of people with that one bug that you fixed. Your contribution will help in building awesome projects. Of course, everyone is going to use your project. If you're contributing to some huge projects, you're going to impact a lot of people. You will gain a deeper knowledge about the project. You will gain a deeper knowledge about the code base or how you need to contribute. Or you can talk about how in a bigger organization, people contribute, collaborate. So those are the things that I want to point out over here. Interact with great developer. Of course, when you contribute to an open source project, you will always have someone who is a better developer who is working on the same. So whenever you contribute, you can interact with them through different open source programs like GSOC, Girlscript Summer of Code, Linux World open source community, etc. So these are the various programs you can participate to gain knowledge about technology and existing improve. Yep, Ketki, correct. So the test your skills. So for example, consider you're learning web development for near about 3 to 4 months now. And I'm sure you all must be working on some or the other personal project. But I'm sure whenever you encounter an issue, you try to fix that issue. But as you are working on a personal level, everyone gets bored and at the same time, we all give up. But if you are working in a open source community, if you are working in a huge community, you always have the motivation. You can test your skills. You can check, because this is the real life project. You can test your skills and check if you know the exact knowledge that you need. And sometimes you will encounter something, a bug or something, and then you will know that, okay, the knowledge that I am having currently is not sufficient. So the your mentor or someone from the community will guide you. So, okay, Rohit, you need to know these things so that you can solve this issue. So you gain two things. You contributed and you learned something new. And you also implemented it in a practical real life issue. So that's one of the major advantages and why you should contribute. And just writing code is not important. Following clean code methodologies, following some concepts like dry, don't repeat yourself. The most important things which will affect you when you will get into an organization or when you will get into open source. So your coding methodologies will improve. You will start writing clean code. You will start writing comments in your code. And that is going to be something which is going to make you a better developer. And finally, it is all about giving back to the community. Whatever you are learning, if you are learning it in the public, make sure you give it back to the community. So someone who is a beginner will also learn. They will learn from your mistakes. They will learn from your contribution. They will learn from you. Moving to the next slide. Yep, meme time. Everyone loves memes. So this is exactly how you feel when you contribute 2 lines to open source project. But make sure that those, so whatever you're contributing is not spam. So don't just convert the H3 tag into H4 and just make some small contribution. Do something that is impactful to the repository, to the project, and it makes a change in everyone's life. So contribute in that way. Next one. Okay, so I'm sure we talked about open source. We talk about why you need to contribute. We looked into the advantages, but what are the things you need to know before stepping into the world of open source? So the basic is you just need to know at least one programming language. So if you know a programming language, for example, consider Python. So if you know Python, you can search for related projects in the open source community, and then you can start contributing, fixing the documentation or adding a function in the code base, etc. You can start small and then work your way up. Learn about version control system. This is one of the most important, and I cannot stress more about it. It's one of the most important thing you need to know when you are going to step into the world of open source. Be active on any platform like GitHub, Bitbucket, GitLab, etc. Because this is where most of the people are of open source are active. Many code repositories are available on GitHub. And of course, willingness to learn and contribute. Moving to the next. Hold up, I'm sure you must have heard something about version control system in the previous slide, but what is version control system? Is the question everyone must be having now. So moving to the version control system part, version control is nothing as fancy or as dreadful as it sounds. It is very easy and simple thing. It is something that records the changes that you make in the project. If you are making any changes, if you are adding a new function or deleting a function or doing anything in the code, it just tracks the file and maintains the history of the project, so that whenever you make a mistake, you can just revert back the mistake and go to the previous stable version. So this is the gist of version control system. The main purpose is that it allows software teams to track changes while it codes and enhance communication and collaboration. For example, many of the open source or software developers are scattered in the different places of the world. So with the help of version control, they can all work simultaneously on the same project, track whatever the other person is doing. And if anyone makes any mistake, everyone can see it and then everyone can rectify it. Or if anyone is trying to add a new feature, the open source community or the with the help of version control system, they can check the new feature. If it is having any issues, they can collaborate and they can communicate it with the person. So this is what version control system is. Basically, it just tracks and keeps a history of the whole project, whole file, and everything that changes in the project is maintained with the help of version control system. Next one. Yep. But why should we use version control system? Is there any other way? Of course, in the earlier stages, there were other ways, but later on they started having their own disadvantages. And as the size of the project grows, the complication increases. And as I said, with this COVID situation going around, everyone is scattered, everyone is at their home. So we can all collaborate and contribute to a same project with the version control system. The first point is revert mistake. So if anyone makes any mistake or if they push any buggy code into the code base, the senior developers or the ones who are expert in that, they of course can revert the mistake. They can get it undone and then they can go to the stable version and then they can rectify the mistake. They can give you a feedback. Okay, so this is where you went wrong. Code it like this and the issue will be solved. Collaboration. Of course, open source is all about collaboration. So you can collaborate on a single simple project and work accordingly, work simultaneously without even disrupting your own work backup. So in case if anything or any of the file of the complete project goes missing, you can always have the backup as the complete history of the project is stored with the help of version control system. And comparison to the earlier version. Many a times we see that software releases their versions, for example, version 2, and if there is a minor change, then they make it 2.1, 2.2. And whenever there is a huge major update, they make it version 3. So you can always compare it to the code base earlier. You can check it out. Next one, Apurva. Yep. So what basically are the types of version control system? So there are actually two major types of version control system. They are centralized and distributed. So let's talk about the centralized one first. So the main concept of centralized system is that it works in a client and server relationship. The server that is in the middle of the whole system has the history and the current file of the whole project. And everyone who wants to work on that project, they have to go to the server and say, okay, I want to contribute. I want to add something to the project, meaningful contribution. So the server will say, okay, this is the latest version of the project. You can have it. So the client takes the latest version and then he starts contributing. But what if other person also wants to work? So then everyone gets the latest version and they start working. So after working, they have to go and push their code into the server. So the term push here just means that you have to add the work you have done to the main server. So at that time, everyone has to add their work to the server and the clients do not have the complete history of the project. They just have the stable, the current latest version with themselves. This is where the issue is with centralized version control. For example, if the central server goes down and you cannot do anything if the central server goes down, everyone has the latest copy of the project, but no one has the entire history. So this will create a nuisance. This is going to create a havoc. I mean, everyone will be in stress and no one knows what to do. So to solve this issue, we have a better version control system type, that is distributed version control system. So in distributed, there is of course a central server and every client has its own local server, so that everything that is there in the server, right from the scratch history, etc., everything is there with every client. So in case if the server goes down, the client can say, okay, I have the complete history. I can put it up in the server and then everyone can use it. So they can, there is no issue if the server goes down. Everyone has the complete history, complete file, and then they can work accordingly. So GitHub is one of the most popular distributed version control system. I mean, nowadays, currently everyone uses GitHub. It is one of the most important and popular thing that a developer must be using. And it is really essential in the community of open source. So before moving further, I would like to ask Apurva to tell you more about GitHub.
So am I audible?
Yep, you're audible.
So hello everyone, I am Apurva Dattir and I am currently the webmaster at PCC ACM student chapter. And I'll be explaining you the concept of GitHub. So what is GitHub exactly? GitHub is basically like a cloud for your code, where developers can store and manage their code. It is like cloud-based service. Developers can track and control their changes that they made to their code. So why do we need GitHub exactly? The main reason and more captivating reason is obviously the collaboration. In version control systems, developer can work collaboratively on a project. They can also control and track their changes that they made to their code. And they can also host their websites for free. It is for the web development projects. If you want to host your website on GitHub, you can do it for free there. And there are many more features of GitHub. And whenever you want to track some changes, like Rohit said before, you can revert back your mistakes. If you are, for example, if you are working on a big chunk of code and you made a certain mistake, and if you want to check where you made that mistake and revert back to your previous code, you can check your changes in the log in GitHub and can revert back to your original code. So now you get a basic idea about GitHub. So now I'll be giving you a walkthrough of how to use GitHub. I'm sure some of you might already have a GitHub account, but for those who don't have a GitHub account, let's start by creating a GitHub account. You can go to the github.com. My screen is visible, right?
Yes, Apurva, you're visible.
Yes, so you can go to the github.com and sign up. Okay, You can add your email. Let's give a username to this. You can give any valid username. So now this username is not available. Okay. If you want any updates, you can type yes or no. There is this puzzle that we have to solve. Okay, so now your account is created. Just verify your account. You can choose the options that you like. So here, collaborative coding. You can continue for free, and you can also get a student developer pack. So this is now your GitHub dashboard. This is how it looks like. On the extreme left corner here, this shows the recent activities or the repositories that you maintain. This middle corner shows all the activities that you've done till now. And from the explore option, you can explore other repositories if you want to know how to create a good repository, what features it should include. So now I've used the word repository too many times, and you must be wondering what a repository is. So let me tell you what a repository is. So basically, on your computer, you create a folder where you store a files. So in GitHub, you create a repository where you store your files, your code. This is what a repository is, and you can access it from anywhere after you store it on GitHub. So let's start by first creating a repository. You can, from this plus sign, you can create a repository here. You should give a valid repository name so that other users can search it if they want to collaborate on your repository. Like if I'm working on a chatbot, chatbot is available. You can give it to your repository name and a brief description about your repository. You can either choose to make it public or private. If you make it public, anyone can see this repository. And if you make it private, only you can see this repository. So what is a README file? It is a good practice to always add a README file to your repository, because you can add your important links in the README file, such as if you create a web development project and you want to host the site. After you host the site, you would like to add your site hosting, like your site's address, to the README file so other users can see what your project is. And also, if you want to give some special steps to the collaborators on how to collaborate to your projects, you can add it to this README file so that collaborators can easily access and collaborate on your project. Gitignore file is something that you want to add if you don't want to show your confidential files on the GitHub to other users. So let's skip these two parts for now. And after this, we create a repository. Now the repository is created with a README file. Now it is only the description that is in the README file, but you can also edit it later. So how to add a file? First, we go here and create a new file if you want to create it, and also upload a new file. So let's start by creating a new file. Let's create a text file, for example. New file. And so now what is committing? Committing is basically saving a file, saving this file on and showing it to your repository. And you should give a proper heading or the title to your commit so that the other contributors should know what you committed. That is, if I'm creating a new file, so I'll added a new text file. And so you can directly edit it to the main branch, directly commit to the main branch, or you can create a new branch. So what is a new branch? Basically, if you create a new branch, you get a isolated environment. You can work freely and experiment on your new branch, and the changes won't be shown on the main branch. And after you're sure of your changes that you made, you can merge the branch with the new branch. So right now I'm just committing it to the main branch. Let's just add. You can by this way, you can add this new way. And I'll just upload a new file for now. You can upload a file by choosing a file. I'm going to add a text file here. Let's just add this file here. And now I added a text file. I'm committing it to the main branch. Now you can see after committing, this new file is shown here, and this is our commit title. So this is how you commit a file. Now let's say I want to, this is just your project, you're working on it. And let's say you want to contribute to some other developer's work. So let's search. So you can see this repository here. Let's say you want to collaborate to this developer's project. So what are the steps that you want to use to collaborate to some other developer's project? So the first thing you need to know is creating an issue. It is a good practice to create an issue first before making some pull request or some changes to this file, to the some other developer's work. So what is the issue? If you want to add changes, made some changes in the development project, you can create an issue and let the developer know what you want to change in the project. If I create a new issue, like give a proper title, change in HTML file. Let's say, and if you want to add some screenshots that how you want to change it or anything, you can add it here and submit new issue. So this is your new issue that is created. You can also add some description. After creating an issue, if you want to work on it, you should fork the repository. So what is forking now? Forking means creating a creating your own copy on your own account. This is now under this user's repository. You can fork it on your own account. It will take a while. So now this is under my name. Now I forked the copy on my account, so I can change it. Let's say I add a new file. Again, uploading the same text file. And amid the changes now. Okay, so I added a new text file, and now I want this text file to be shown on the main repository, that is this repository. So here I have to make a pull request. So now what is a pull request? After you create an issue, you told the owner that what you want to change in the repository. Now making a pull request, you will push your code into the main repository, and the owner will review the changes, and if all the changes are good, the owner will merge the repository into its own repository. So for making a pull request, you have to click on the new pull request and compare across forks. So it is the base repository is this, the main repository, and for the head repository from which you want to compare, choose your own repository. So after choosing this, it will compare across the two different forks. The main fork is, that is this repository, main repository, and the head repository is your own repository. It will show the commits made. That is, we added a text file here. Now we want to create a pull request. So add a valid title again. Same, add a new comment here, and then create a pull request. So now this shows that there are no external conflicts with the base branch, so it is good to go. Now the owner will review the changes that we made, and if the changes are good, then the owner will merge our branch into this original repository. So this is how you contribute to other developers' work, and this is the concept of issues and pull requests. It is basically a very simple process if you get a hold of it. So yes, this is about GitHub, and if you want to use any external tools, there is also this GitHub Student Developer Pack, where you get so much premium features that are very helpful for students, like Canva or many other features. You can check that out. So yeah, this is about GitHub.
Apurva?
Yes.
Can you please show the process to fork a repository again, as some of the contestants are having doubt over here?
Okay, I couldn't check the chat box. Okay, so for forking a repository, okay, one second. Hello, am I audible?
Actually, Apurva, you are not audible for the few minutes right now.
My net got disconnected. Am I audible right now?
Yep.
Yeah, you are.
Okay, so to fork a repository, let's say I am forking this repository right here. You just have to go to this fork option right here. Forking, it makes the copy of your repository to your own account. So let's click on the fork, and it will create a fork. Okay, so here it is. This is the, it shows here, it is forked from this repository, and this is my own repository. Now you can freely work on this, and then after working on it, you can push the changes to the main repository. Is there any more doubt? So yeah, this is about the GitHub. Now I would like to call Rohit for the further process.
Yep. That was actually nice, Purva. So as I said earlier in the agenda, we are having a surprise. So can anyone guess what it is? If anyone has any guesses or something, how do I download file in the repo to change them locally on my PC? Apurva, would you like to show that?
Sorry, can you repeat that? I couldn't hear you.
How do I download the files in a repo to change them locally on my PC? He's asking about the clone, how you can clone it and open it on the VS Code.
Okay. Let me show this. So this is your file. In the code section, you can, if you have a GitHub desktop, you can directly open it with the GitHub desktop. But if you want to clone it, you have to go to the GitHub CLI, or you can also go here and copy this. And if you have Git installed on your repository, on your PC, you can use the command git clone and paste this link over there. So it will copy your repository to your PC, and you can freely work on it, just like you would work on any other folder. Does that clear anything? Hello, am I audible?
He got clear.
Is there any doubt?
I guess no. Aditya got it.
Okay.
So I was talking about the surprise. So anyone, any guess what it is? I guess no one. Okay, cool. No issues. Moving to the next one. Hacktoberfest. Awesome, Rohit. We are going to have Hacktoberfest. So what basically is Hacktoberfest will also be the question you'll be having. So Hacktoberfest is a month-long celebration of open source, whose motive is to, inspire or motivate people to get into open source, contribute to different projects and gain some knowledge and share your knowledge. So this is a month-long festival related to open source held in the month of October. Of course, there are some rewards that you get if you meet a certain criteria during the complete month of October. So we are going to have Hacktoberfest in our college, when we will be having different repositories for different domains. And then everyone who are willing to contribute can contribute on these repositories or projects. So in case we are having a repository for example, a web development or a website, you all can contribute if you have the relevant skills or you want to learn them. You can contribute over there. And also we are going to have a session on the coming weekend wherein we will introduce you to these repositories. We will tell you more in detail about how to contribute so that you can also follow the complete procedure and contribute to the projects. So that is something that we are also looking forward to. And we want you all to contribute. I'm sure the first try will always be a bit messy, but you all will get better with consistent trials. That's the motto of Hacktoberfest. And we will also reveal the rewards during the coming weekend session. So you will get to know what the rewards are and how to contribute, how to use Git, how you can open a file in VS Code and then push and pull your changes, etc. So there are more things coming this weekend. We are looking forward to it. And thank you. Next slide. So thank you, everyone. If you have any questions, feel free to drop them in Q&A. Okay, Adiraj, how to upload the code which we have on PC to GitHub? Okay, Adiraj, you can use GitHub desktop. If you have a local project of yours, you can use GitHub desktop and add it directly to your GitHub account so that the project or folder which you have on your local machine can be on the GitHub as well. Okay, Sejal, Yep. We'll be showing this in a hands-on session this weekend. We'll be sharing our screen. We'll be showing it with a hands-on session. So don't worry about it.
Yes, the process is quite easy. And we'll show you from end to end project.
Okay, Pranav, Sadaf, okay, I'm from outside of your college, but today's session is too great. But shall you tell me how do I get latest updates? First of all, thank you, Pranav, for the appreciation. You can join our Discord server. Suraj, can you drop the Discord server link in the chat box so that...
Yeah, just give me a minute. We'll do it.
Yep. In Hacktober, if our pull request is not accepted. Okay, Pranav, Dad. Yep, of course. We'll also share the feedback if your pull request is not accepted. Many a times the pull requested is not accepted due to some common reasons. We'll share them in the coming session. Do we have any more questions? I mean, we are looking forward to your questions because that's how you're going to learn.